Okay, hello. I'm Redon Skikuli. I'm probably doing some mistake based on the reactions I got. So we also have like Albanian, the first one, which is the country I'm from. English, bonjour is the French one, and Dutch. Is this okay? So what is there anything else missing? No. So we had a very nice discussion yesterday with some of the presenters at the dinner, and I learned about all the complex things about the language. I think I'm in a good to go. Perfect. So, and this also means hello. What's up in Albanian? So it's spelled Shkemi, with she at age or whatever. So usually in presentation at FOSDEMs. In FOSDEM, I've been here for three times, I think, or four. Usually, the majority of the talks are quite technical, and I feel quite not qualified to follow them all. So, but I'm very, very interested about the human elements of each presentation, all the presenters. And since there are not a lot of them, so I was thinking that I'm going to do the start and say, before presenting the presentation, I just want to the application. I just want to share the reasons why I started it along with some other people. So as I mentioned, this is me when I was a kid. I asked my mom some photos, and she sent me like I don't know everything she had in from since I was a kid. But these are only two of them. And I was born in a city called Elbasan. These are the locations for the city. I hope these are correct. The good thing with locations is that it's a universal language, so everybody understands. When we say north and east, everybody understands where it is. So Elbasan, if you go to the map, is in the center. In Albania, if you go to the map of Albania, it's exactly in the geographical center of it. It's a very boring city in general. Is this getting recorded? it's a very boring, but it has a very geeky element. Especially at the neighborhood where I was living. It was the train route was going there every day. And the most interesting part was that our parents was always telling us, don't go there. And it's getting recorded as well. We were not going there every day. And it was amazing because you are also going, we are having all these networks of trains, and it's very interesting to understand how they work. So I think that was the first moments when I understand that I like, you know, to understand how things work in the beginning. So Elbasan is in Albania, and these are the this is the location of it, and it's for probably there people don't know where it is, which is okay, no offense taken. It's near Greece, Italy is there as well, and some other non-EU countries which are bordering us. I'm not going to tell more about it, but it's well known. I think it's the most well known thing is that. Before, from 1945, after the Second World War, till 1990 or 1991, we had a dictatorship. And one of the things that the crazy guy we had was that he built a lot of bunkers, like in mountains and also in the sea. They are counting, I think there were more than 173,000 of them built. It's a similar situation with North Korea right now. So getting from this environment, Albania was very closed, probably the most closed. We didn't have, for a decade or two, we didn't have any diplomatic relationship with any countries in the world. So a lot of people, nobody was going in, coming in, a few people were going out. And it was very bad to go. So in the 1997, my parents and myself, we went in Athens. Which also influenced me a lot to do what I was doing, and it's a neighborhood. I was staying a lot in a neighborhood called Exarchia, which is a very political neighborhood in general. It's well known, especially if you are into all these things. So there were these very that was the first moment, and I learned about like doing things, you know. People were talking a lot. I was amazed how much people were gathering and talking about politics and all this stuff, being equal, and you know all the elements that you need to discuss in a collective way. So this is also something that influenced me. This from from the uprising of 2008 when a kid was killed there. And of course, you're going to see a lot of these signs, which unconsciously influence you in one way or the other. So in 2012, I went back in Tirana and with some other people who started a very small hackerspace, which is which I think it's now it's 5 years. We take pride in the fact that we have slightly more diversity in terms of getting not only white boys like myself, but the majority of the people are girls that hang out there and are under 25. We also had one of our members be nominated as Red Hat Open Source Girl of the Year. She's one of the finalists. So it's a very, we try to be diverse, although this is not only, there are more elements in being diverse than just having not only white boys in the room. One of the events we do is Open Source Conference Albania. It's in May, in this third weekend of May. And I know a lot of people are joining there as well. So we had some, we are still, there are a group of people working in the hackerspace, which also has this, we try to be as open in decision making as possible. And this is one of the things I love, having this background of, you know, politically influenced from my teenage years and after that. So we have different working groups. There is a working group for Fedora. There's a working group for Debian. Mozilla has a lot of contributors. And one of these working groups is OpenStreetMap. And another one is Wikipedia. So there are like five or six working groups that are quite active. And I started my first, if you can see there, it's in September 2012. I started playing around with OpenStreetMap. I'm pretty sure there are more active contributors of OpenStreetMap than myself, but I think what I understood during all this period is it's very important also to try to make a lot of community building so that the local other people start learning the importance of OpenStreetMap as a platform, etc. And after editing, if you see the stats and if you go to my profile, you're going to see that I just do simple stuff. Like I just edit the working hours of some cafeteria, or let's say I just map buildings based on the big imagery, not complicated stuff. I'm being honest when I say I'm trying for a long time to learn JOSM, and I failed to learn it as long as I want to do it. But what I was fascinating a lot was the fact that there are other applications using OpenStreetMap as a base map to create very, very useful things. One application I use a lot is maps.me, and I was using it to get around Brussels these days. And there is also StreetComplete, which I think is having a lot of traction out there. And I think older than maps.me should be OSMN, which I don't have it right here. The thing with all these platforms is that they, some of them, or let's say the ones that are more mainstream or are used more, try to have this tendency of being a Swiss knife. Like you can also go from point A to point B. You can also search a category. You can do offline search, online search. You can also edit the map, etc., etc. But what I really like more is are these apps like Bike Citizens, or there is another one I like. It's called Transporters, which is about the open. It's an open source map about public transportation in different areas, and I'm following their GitHub account, which is quite active lately. And I really like those, not the general, like the general, but the apps that do specific tasks, and they are good at it. And OpenStreetMap as a base map for this is quite interesting because it lets you do also the most complicated tasks if you want to navigate, but also the simplest task. I think Bike Citizens does this, but also there are a couple of other apps about biking that are doing the same job in one way or the other. So yeah, as I mentioned, I really didn't. I think there are some elements for platforms like OpenStreetMap or some apps that can go even more mainstream. And you cannot do that, in my opinion, by being a Swiss knife or doing whatever you can with one application, and also web apps. So being fascinated by the capabilities of a platform like this, I said, well, there are some things that are missing out there. For example, I want I live in a city which is not big. I think it's something less than half a million people, but it has a lot of things I need on a daily basis. I just recently got a bike, and I need like a drugstore, for example, or points of interest that are not branded, or that there are more like categories, right? So if you are living in a big city, or you travel from one city to the other, so in Brussels I need to go to the supermarket. I don't know what the point B or where I'm going to go is. I just want it to be close to myself. And this is a need I personally found that it's much needed all the time. So I also care about privacy. And I really like, it would be nice if I wanted to edit OpenStreetMap, but without all the 100 elements that you can go there, right? So, and of course I didn't want it to be like a startup or like to ask for money, investments and stuff like that, but I also wanted to be a community-led. Growing up, I understand that I'm very good on initiating stuff and making the structure of so that other people can join. But after that, like, I'm not interested anymore. So this, when it's community-led, like community, you are not responsible anymore after a while. You're responsible in the beginning, but after a while, it's so for lazy people, this is the best approach you can have. And these open source communities are the best in implementing this. No shareholders, and you can do something else, or you can contribute on the project you started or not. Free open source, of course, respect the privacy, but also we need, going back to the story I told you about Athens, you also need something that is fair for people that contribute, and also the people that initiated this process. So it's like, I don't know, like, you know, having a fair system, financial system for people that contribute. So this was all the thoughts before starting CityZen as an application. And if you go to citizenapp.co, you're going to see the old website. But now we are working on having it on GitHub pages so that more people, because we have having Twitter messages, hey, I want to translate your website, so how can I do it? So now we are moving it on GitHub pages so that more people localize and translate it. And you can also download it. It's only available on F-Droid for privacy reasons. No Google Play plans at the moment. And if you go and you open the application, you're going to see different categories. These are six, but I think at the moment there are more than that. So transportation, gas stations, pharmacies, drug stores, banks, ATMs, mobile phone stores, markets, and kiosks, right? And there are some couple more. So if you go to one of these categories, you're going to see banks, ATMs, or exchange. If you live outside the EU, an exchange store is very, very important. And you see some basic information when it's open, when it's closed, the name of it. And you can, at the moment, you have basic filtering. If it's the information is on OpenStreetMap, you can see 24/7, if it's open 24/7, or you can, if you see a lot of results, you can make it sorted alphabetically, kind of. And you can also see where in the map your location is. So this bank was there. Now you know where I was staying before. But if you click on that point of interest, you can also see more details, like if it has wheelchair access or any information about that is on OpenStreetMap. Not all of the information, but the main ones. And if you click on directions by car, you can have the very basic navigation of how to go by car. At the moment, this is very limited features that there are on the app. But you can also edit it. If you are an OpenStreetMap editor, you can just log in easily, and you can also edit opening hours, or if it has a Wi-Fi connection in a cafeteria, this is very useful, and other stuff. Everything is done live in terms of that there is no offline usage. You just get connected. It's a very nice, it's that simple, it's a very nice interface for OpenStreetMap, for people like my dad or like my mom that just want to do this without getting into the trouble. And you can also have some favorites. This is the about page when you can log in or log out of OpenStreetMap, and you can also have some more links about the website and stuff like that. So, as I mentioned, I'm quite lazy, so I don't want to do everything by myself. And these are some main ways of how you can get involved if you like the project, which has started only for three or more months. So there is a GitHub page with all the code, but also there is some different repo. The code, the Android development repo has some issues that are done by the core team that is working on this, but also there are other people. I was happy to meet some of them here as well. There are all kind of issues like design, which is could be better, or you know, fixing some bugs. There are a lot of bugs at the moment, but you can also get involved. There is a repo about task, any kind of task you can think. Like for this presentation, I can open an issue and write down, and people talk there and see what's happening. That's quite an active repo at the moment. You can get involved in localizing the app. I think it was launched in October, if I'm wrong, November, something like that. And already these are all these languages translated. There are not a lot of strings, I think 100 or 110 strings about the interface of the application. But it can also help now in the website that is just getting launched. And like there are some Chinese simplified and traditional from people, or Norwegian translations from people I've never met before, which is so like, it's a weird feeling when you see things like this with an application that you just started. There is also this week we're going to launch the Patreon campaign, which means that you can give €1 on a monthly basis and get something back, which might be from stickers to endless love from all the people that are working on this. Endless love costs more usually because it's another. These are levels that you get. Of course, that's the big trend now with cryptocurrencies. And you can also donate by Bitcoin, but there is a big transaction fee, I think €5-7 or something. So only if you have like a lot of like hundreds of thousands of euros, that would be a very good idea. We will not ask you about the source of your money, definitely. So what about the next steps, because we don't have much time. So this app also started as a tool for people to pay in a very anonymous way. I know it's complicated, like there are tons of everybody's talking about this right now, but I think the first applications that will connect points of interest, like mini markets, gas stations, with a platform that people can pay easily and anonymously, would be a very useful tool for everybody. Right? So this is one thing. So if you are at the gas station, the idea is to work. It is a long shot task, by the way. So you just pay for the gas station with your crypto wallet embedded on the app. Okay, we can talk about this later. And I know a lot of people will laugh. So there is also about if you want to contribute and you also want some financial incentives, there is a utopian.io integration with any open source project where you can work on issues on GitHub or any other other aspect and get some crypto payments from the platform, which is a very smart way to get more contributes. So you contribute and get better code that gets verified by us, and you get your crypto, which, again, you're going to be millionaires if you have a lot of crypto right now. So you can also have help us on the community infrastructure, on set up a mailing list and a forum, keyword lazy, and also I don't have the technical knowledge to, you know, to mess up with servers and stuff like that, and even more improvements. So if there are ideas, you can go to the GitHub repo and add any kind of new idea that you might have. at the moment. Last slide. When I had the idea of the app, I just wanted for an easy, also one of the reasons was that I wanted the easy way for me and other people to contribute to OpenStreetMap. So I introduced it to my niece some, I think 10 days ago, and she has already done 110 edits on her OpenStreetMap edit. So if this doesn't, if the application by itself doesn't work, I'm very happy with it, because you know, even one person that started contributing in it, it's a very, very big win. And also, the sad thing about this is that I feel the generation gap coming. She's so fast with the app, and she edits everything. So she lives in Elbasan now, and there are no more cafeterias without any kind of information available at the moment, because she did everything. Her mom shouldn't know that she edits only cafeterias, and they also want rating now. Like she was talking with her friends, and they want to rate the cafeterias. So these cafeterias are for old people, and these are for young people. I tried to explain to her that that's not a good idea to comment on OpenStreetMap. So yeah, that's it. So, I don't know if you have any questions. I'll be more than happy to answer you for 10 minutes. No, 8? 5 minutes. Yes. Thank you. Sorry, I didn't get it.
So, are any features that you feel you are missing because you have embraced privacy?
No, the privacy element is by far not where it should be. For example, if you the fact that we are using it's an Android app, by default is a privacy issue. For example, there is a Mozilla geolocation feature that you can integrate on an app, and I think you get out of the Google tracking your geolocation. Unfortunately, I don't have the know-how if that's true or not, but that's one of the features that we want to implement. Another one is that somebody proposed, because automatically it asks you for your location, right? When you open the app, it asks you for a location. So a guy said, well, don't ask for it. So we need to remove it now. Don't ask for the geolocation so that people can zoom in, zoom out, and you know, go where they want to go and see what's around. So these are the two features that are on the priority list: the integration with the Mozilla Geo something tool, and also the removing completely the ability to automatically connect to the geolocation from the mobile. In terms, and also the crypto payments thing, it's quite a thing, but it's a long shot. No other questions?
Are you downloading the OSM data live for your local thing? I think you said it doesn't work offline.
Yeah, it's alive. It's alive. It's actually the app is. I know it's not good marketing, but it's just a nice interface, or it should be a nice interface for OpenStreetMap data in a category. So it's alive. It's not an offline.
Isn't that a privacy leak itself?
If you are,
for example, the downloading a few bits near where you are and do them in a random order, so anybody watching your network communication won't know quite which bit you're most interested in.
Yes, but that happens with any applications that access the internet at any point. So that's by definition an issue with all the applications that are connected to the internet, or actually anything that's transmitted through the internet. No?
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Very nice. Very modest.